It's good to see you all here tonight. It's good to see Francis with us here. I was just thinking as the choir was singing, Patrick here, his last Maundy Thursday before he goes off to college. Appreciated him in the choir. We're still praying for Johnny. Good to see Linda here tonight. So we all come just as we are in this Holy Week on this Maundy Thursday, to listen for God's Word, to see where we are, and to see where God may want us to be. I invite you to listen to the reading tonight from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 14, verses 10 through 27. It is about Jesus' Last Supper, which is what we remember on Maundy Thursday. Listen for what the Spirit is saying to the church. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray Jesus to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me. One who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and to say to him one after the other, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.'" The word of the Lord for us this evening. Thanks be to God. In silence, let us pray to the Lord. Amen. Judas was in charge of the money. It's always disheartening when the one who's in charge of the money is disloyal to the group. We here in this presbytery had an experience of that nature in the last 10 years, where someone on the presbytery staff was taking advantage of his position, and the presbytery is still finally on the verge of paying back monies that were misplaced and misappropriated. Of course, it's a little worse with Judas and Jesus because Judas was actually personal friend, disciple. In fact, there's even a legend from the Arabic infancy gospel that tells a story of Mother Mary and baby Jesus having also another couple living with them, and a mother and child, and the boy who was growing up with Jesus was possessed with an evil spirit, and whenever someone would come around him, he would bite them. And he never bit Jesus, his little friend, but he did strike him in the side. And that little boy grew up to be Judas Iscariot. Just a legend that points toward the personal nature of the relationship between Jesus and Judas, who betrayed Jesus with a kiss. When you think of betrayals in the Gospels or in the biblical canon, you think of Joseph. Remember Joseph? Had the many colored coat. His dad loved him best. And his brothers were so jealous when Joseph had the dream of him sitting on the throne and his brothers all bowing before him. And they got so upset they sold him into slavery. He was taken down to Egypt, went through a whole series of experiences, had the ability to interpret dreams, and rose up in the kingdom until he was second in command of Pharaoh. And there came a time when there was a famine in the land, and so his brothers had to come down to Egypt looking for food and salvation from starvation. And imagine their surprise when they see it's Joseph sitting on the throne that they have to petition for the food. And there's such a poignant scene there where Joseph recognizes his brothers whom he's not seen in so many years and forgives them and tells them, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good, so that you could be saved." We wonder if Judas meant it for evil. Or was he just disappointed when things didn't go like he thought they might, when he thought Jesus might become political leader, king of Israel, and Jesus chose another path and said, "My kingdom is not of this world." And that finally sinks in. And if your kingdom is not of this world, well, I'll take something that is, that being 30 pieces of silver. Better than a prayer. And so Judas betrayed Jesus in the garden. And unfortunately for Jesus, this was only the beginning of a series of betrayals over the next 24 hours that would include Peter, who's in the courtyard down below where Jesus is up with Pontius Pilate on trial, and Peter's down here with a servant girl who recognizes him as he's warming himself at the fire and says, "Hey, you were with Jesus." And Peter says, "No." And then cock crows. And then the girl says to some other friends, I know that this man was with them because I saw him." He says, "No, I wasn't with them." And then cock crows the second time. And then the servant girl says, you've got a Galilean accent. I know good and well you're part of the group. No. And he cursed and said, I am not part of their group. And the cock crowed the third time. And immediately he remembered that Jesus had said this was going to happen. And he broke down and he wept. Betrayed by Peter. And of course the crowd betrayed Jesus. When he had come in on Palm Sunday, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, in the same crowd. On the day after the Last Supper would be yelling, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him, betrayed by the crowd. But worst of all, as Jesus was hanging on the cross, he cries out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Forsaken by God. Quoting from Psalm 22, which Linda will read later in the service as we're stripping the church. So think about Jesus saying that from the cross. As Jesus said here in our text this evening, you will all become deserters. And they did. And so Jesus experienced what Shakespeare called the heartache, the thousand natural shocks, or what, in a more homely expression, as Elvis sang, when you find your sweetheart in the arms of your best friend, that's when your heartache begins. That's the end of your sweetheart, it's the end of your best friend. That's when your heartache begins. Or as they used to sing on Hee-Haw, gloom, despair, and agony on me. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Jesus said it much more eloquently as he quoted from Psalm 22. We betray Christ too. We betray Christ when we betray the Christ within, our true selves, our godly nature. When we deny our godly nature and succumb to our animal nature, our reptilian brain, we deny Jesus. When we fail to love others because we fail to see the Christ within them, we betray Jesus. And yet, as the hymn puts it, just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, O Lamb of God, I come. And we come. We come to the table. We come to the Maundy Thursday service. We come to the choir practice. We come to the session meeting. We come and we come and we come. Hoping that God will meet us there. Well, I say God will meet us here. And I say God will meet you there, at your house, in your car, where you work, when you travel. Because it's not about trying to connect with a God who's way up in the sky somewhere, up in the heavens. It's just a matter of connecting with the Christ that is already within. Within you, within me. And trying to be faithful to that, that love, that light within. And trying not to once again betray the Christ within.